the day. We thank you so much for the opportunity to once again be here to just love you and adore you. Father, we pray that everything we do today is pleasing to you and that we will truly love and adore you this morning through the songs, through the service that we give to you. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. Amen.
Happy birthday to you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
In bad blood. We're all pretty much familiar with it. If you've ever seen you've heard a song by Taylor Swift called it, you know that it talks about relationships and sometimes how people come into conflict with each other. Bad blood is representative of the hatred that people can have between each other, just simply falling out of a relationship. And it also talks about, if you've ever seen the Lee Memorial, Blood Center come through, and you've ever seen anybody who's had poisoned blood, you know that it makes you pretty sick pretty easily. There's a lot of people who need it. And I would just say this morning that we all kind of have poisoned blood. It's because sin in our life, and a falling out of our relationship with our Father in heaven. And it says in Scripture, specifically John chapter 6, 53 to 56, so Jesus said to them, meaning the disciples, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him." You see, sometimes we all need a transfusion. And our blood is bad. Our blood is bad because of our brokenness and our sin, and the choices that we've made that have separated us from the holy God that we serve. But Jesus' blood, when we have the transfusion of Jesus' blood that comes into us, he makes us clean. When we abide in him, he abides in us and comes through. And communion is meant to represent that, to proclaim his death, that by trusting and believing in him, by taking that into our bodies, it makes us clean. And just a fun fact, nutrients that are in those things, what the comprised elements, the Eucharist, when you ingest that into your body, it becomes a part of who you are. So it literally becomes a part of who you are today. And maybe you come here with bad blood, maybe you feel a bit poisoned, maybe you need to be made clean. We all need to reflect on that for ourselves. But Jesus' blood is the transfusion that makes us holy. Not by anything we did, but by the sacrifice that makes our blood pure and restores us to the Father.
Let's begin on attitude of prayer. Father, as we come before you in our humble lives this morning, as we partake of the body of Christ through the bread and the blood of Christ through the wine, as we partake of this transfusion, as we are infused with the pure body and with the pure blood, may we walk forth this week so that others may see Christ come alive in us. Bless this body and this blood this morning as we partake, as we renew, as we remember, and as we walk with you. We ask this in Jesus, our risen Lord and Savior's name. Amen.
Thank you. prayer. Father in heaven, we come to you today not only to worship you in your house, but to give thanks for everything that you do for us. Thank you, Lord, for sending your only Son, that he may suffer and die on the cross, that we may have eternal life. We thank you, Lord, for making it possible for us to earn a living and to support our family. And at this time, we'd like to give a portion of that back to you, that your kingdom may grow. We ask you to bless the gift as well as the giver. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
He is doing a self-proclaimed said, I want to look at myself as a prophet, and I want to look at myself as a priest. I want to look at myself as what I do. How well have I done it? And so I said, well, that seems good. So each one of us today can look at ourselves. Because if you understand scriptures, you are a what?
Study.
Well, you guys are... That time change still hasn't caught up with you, has it? Okay. You are either a minister or a mission field. Well, that's what we were told. Minister or mission field. I've kind of tweaked it because I think we're always a little bit of a mission field, even when we minister. You know, because how many of you know it all? Yeah, I knew you two would reach your hand. How many of you know it all? We don't. So we constantly need someone to be a missionary to us, telling us the word and what it's about. How many of you are ministers? Scripture says that if you are His, you are a minister. So your goal is to go ye therefore into all the world seeking, preaching, I mean, everything about it, right? So how many of you are doing that? That's why the church is half empty. Oh no, it's half empty. You can look at it as positive as you want, but it's a bad thing when there's an empty seat next to you. Right, Pam?
Yes.
What's your excuse?
I
ain't taking
showers this morning. Been prepared.
So what we're going to find in the book of Micah as he reviews himself, he comes up with four things he thinks that the world needs. Okay? He starts off in chapter 7. Chapter 7, verse 1, he starts off with these words. Some of you in your version might say, what misery is mine? Or it might say in others, woe is me. Okay, he's saying, woe. What misery is mine? I mean, what have I done for God? So we'll start right there. What have you done for God? Review your life. Run the tape back. What have you done for God, let's just say, this week? Rewind the tape for this week only. What have you done for God? Another way of saying that is, what difference in this world did I make for the kingdom this week? You got it? How many of you made a difference for the kingdom this week? Because of your life, because you were here. You see, because Michael was looking, he says, God has put me here for a purpose and for a reason, and I need to be about that purpose and that reason. And if I'm not about the purpose and the reason, why am I here? Woe is me if I'm not about what God wants me to be about. Now, he doesn't say in there that you can't travel. He doesn't say in there that you can't have fun. He doesn't say in there that you can't go to a game or that you can't do housework or you can't. But he's saying when you do all those things, God first. When you do those things, show God. Shine Him through you. And so he's coming in here and he said, as he goes through, we'll read one section. The whole chapter's about it. So some of the chapters before, but go to verse 14, chapter 7. He starts off by saying, shepherd your people with your staff, the flock of your inheritance, which lives by itself in a forest and fertile pasture lands. Let them feed in Bashan and Gilead as in days long ago. Now he's saying, shepherd your people. Who are your people?
Members of the congregation.
Who? Members of the congregation. Their
congregation?
Members of your community, those you come in contact with. So shepherd those that your life crosses their path. Now, what does it mean to shepherd?
Teach,
guide, nourish, lead. It even says in scriptures that a good shepherd will die for his flock. Now, if it's just someone I just met at Walmart, I would have to think long and hard if I'm going to die for them. If it's my mom or my sister or brother-in-law who are sitting here this morning, or other brother-in-law who are sitting here, I mean, family, now we don't have to think so hard. If it came down to it, me or them, well, then take me. But he wants you to shepherd your flock. And he uses these two terms, Bashan and Gilead. Now, why did he use those terms? Let them feed in Bashan and Gilead. Because they were known as the droughtless areas of the world. Even when major drought and famine came on, these two areas were fertile. So he said, let them feed there because they will always be nourished. They will always be there. Now, if you study your Bible, you know this. There was one instance where Bashan and Gilead were touched by drought. There was an instance in our lives that Bashan and Gilead, the garden, was touched by drought. Here, when he's talking about drought, he's talking about sin. And when Micah goes into this whole thing, he starts going through history and he says, you know, we had this garden, this Bashan and Gilead that we were allowed to feed in and be in and be nourished in and be led. I mean, and the good shepherd, God himself, was there and guided us through and drought. What was the cause of drought? Man. What did man do? Sin. And he said, so the garden was touched and we were sent out. And we were sent out and we sinned more and things came to a point and came to a head that God saw fit to teach his people a lesson. And Micah, through his book, talks about being sold into bondage. He goes back in history, says they were sold into bondage and they were let out. They had a great exodus. And Micah talks about us needing the shepherd. Now he talks about us too needing a great exodus. And he says, what I believe the world is going to need, he says in here, is a second exodus. Has the world become bad enough that God needs to save it? Now Micah's Old Testament, he's talking about this great exodus. And he even talks some about the one who will come. Do we all know who the one is that will come? We know it because we have the New Testament, right? And we know that Jesus came to what?
Save us.
Not to destroy us, but to save us. Why did he come to save us? We know it in John 3:16, don't we? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For he did not send his Son into the world to condemn it, but that we might be saved. I mean, we know those verses, don't we? And so Micah here is reiterating all this stuff we know. We know about the garden, we know about sin. We know about Moses and the Exodus that they had. We know what happened during the Exodus. We know that in the middle of the Exodus, the people what? Sin. They built a calf made out of gold because Moses had left them for a period. Because their leader was gone. And Micah talks about that happening to us. Where's our leader today? Where's Jesus? At the right hand of God. Supposedly in us still. He left the Holy Spirit to be in us and be a part of us. And so we're supposed to have this. But he's saying, Mike's saying, we need another great exodus. And there's going to be one that comes that's going to save us. And that one who comes to save us will lead a great second exodus. Now what is he talking about?
Second coming.
There's going to be a time when Jesus is going to come back and those who are his are going to be gone. We're going to go to the place prepared for us. Now there's a movie out called The Shack where they talk about getting what you can get kind of thing, what's there and stuff. I mean, we have to understand that Jesus says himself, I go to prepare a place for me, for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, surely I will what?
Come again.
Come again. So that you may be where I am also. I mean, we're going to be there. It's going to happen. So Micah, this great prophet, is telling people there's going to be this second coming, this second exodus of people, and you want to be a part of it. Don't you?
Amen.
I mean, don't you want to be where he is also? I mean, we talk about it all the time, inherit. What does it mean to inherit? It means if somebody died or they left you something, you get what?
Yeah.
Whatever they left you. You get how much of it?
All of it.
Jesus went as the Son of God to heaven. He sits at the right side of the Father. And we are considered sons and daughters, heirs to him, heirs to the throne. So we get what?
Eternal salvation.
Everything. We get everything the Bible talks about. The great feast, the salvation, the life eternal, the glory in heaven, the praise and worship, the streets of gold. We get everything. We're heirs to that. How many of you are willing to give that up? We aren't. How many of you sin? How many of you willingly sin sometimes? So you're willing to what?
Give it up.
It's not God taking it. It's us giving it up. Scripture tells us that when we sin, we get separated from God. He can't have anything to do with that sin, so we get separated from Him. If we're separated from Him, how can we inherit what He has for us? And so Micah, talking, says we need a good shepherd to lead us. We need a second exodus. We need a clean sign of what's to come. Micah mentions judgment. How many of you are ready for judgment? How many of you are ready for the Hipwil? You stand before God or Jesus and He says, how did you prepare and what did you learn? How did you prepare for heaven? And what did you learn along the way that gets you there? How many of you learned about a relationship? How many of you know there's no other way to get there but through that relationship, through that person? There's no other way to heaven but through Jesus Christ. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me, he says. It's not by Muhammad, not by Sun Myung Moon, it's not by your neighbor, it's not by the hope you put in a TV preacher. It's not in any of those things. I'm not going to get you to heaven. I'm standing here this morning as big of a sinner as you are. I don't have the ability to forgive you or to save you or do any of that. But Jesus Christ does. And the Scripture tells us He's the only one that does it. So we need that. And we need a clear sign, and the sign is going to be judgment. We're going to stand before Him one day and we're going to Hipwil to Him. Man, I thought I hated those in college. I had better be ready. I had better prepare for that one that's coming up. You know, to be able to answer to him and be ready for that. And then he closes out, Micah closes out his whole thing with, this thought. The world needs unity and love. I wanted to play the song. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. You know, nothing else will do. I mean, nothing else there. We need love, and love, we know from Scripture, is God. God is love. What the world needs now is God. God's going to answer those questions. We were in Sunday school class. We talked about this man, Mr. Hen, who took $3 million worth of gold coins, diamonds, and gems, and put them in a box and buried them somewhere. He really did this. His goal was to get people out from behind the TV, out from their computer games, out into the world to experience life, and to search for a treasure. And if you look him up, you're going to find that there's 30-some thousand people who have given everything in their life to find that treasure. They talk about people living in their cars, living in tents in the desert and everything, and digging everywhere they can dig. And every year he gives more hints. And they said he did this because he had cancer and he thought he was going to die, and he wanted to give something to make people search. Search life. But they said he survived cancer, so every year he posts a little thing like, it's not buried by a monument. Don't dig up monuments. And he posted, it's not buried in a cemetery. Don't dig up graves. And he keeps giving them posts, but he doesn't tell them where. He makes them search. He says, it was all meant to get out. Gang, if you were going to search for a treasure, what do you want to search for? You want to spend this life looking for a box that holds $3 million? Or do you want to search for a treasure that gets you everything? Even eternity. Craig said, priceless. I think he's right. I think it's worth a whole lot more than $3 million. To know that I will live forever in the kingdom of God. To know that I inherit it all. No more searching. No more trying to dig up the treasure. We know what the treasure is. The treasure in itself is Jesus Christ. And we've got to find that, and we find it only in the love of God. We find it only when we search the right things. God. When we accept the right things. Jesus. When we use the right things. The Holy Spirit. To get through this life. To be able to answer the question and attest to it. And was Micah a wise man? Or was he just a man that God used to get his message across? You see, I'm not a brain. I'm not the smartest man in the world. But I know that God can use me to get his message across. And as Micah is here reviewing his ministry, looking at his life, I mean, this week, putting this together, I had to review my ministry and my life. What is it I've done for the kingdom? What difference is there in the world because I lived this week? What difference will there be in this world this week because God gives me another week to live? And if you know scriptures, we're not guaranteed of tomorrow. So I better have done it right today. You see, I'm not the smartest man. I don't know that Micah was the smartest man, but I know that Micah was used by God, and I know that I'm willing to allow God to use me to get the message out so that you understand what God wants from you. And this week, he's relying on you to get the message out to those in the world, to those that you come in contact with, to your family, to your friends, to the lady you walk into at Walmart, to the cashier behind the counter at the gas station, to whoever it is, to get the message out. What's the message?
Jesus.
The message that Micah was given was God loves you. The people were feeling like they were left behind. They were feeling like they didn't. In fact, it was like, no, God still loves you. Even in the midst of your trouble, in the midst of your sin, in the midst of what you've done in this life, God loves you. And God still has a plan for you if you can get beyond the sin. And the only way to get beyond the sin is Jesus. To accept the love gift of God in your life. And not just say, yeah, I believe, but to live that belief. Then say, okay, because I believe, I now must what?
Love others.
How do we do that?
In Christ.
If God is love, I have to have God to love. In order to love others, and if I truly love them, I'll give them Christ for them. So that they can be where I'm going. Because the alternative is too hard to think of, isn't it? We sit here today and imagine your best friend, or your husband, or your wife, or a family member, or a close friend, that you didn't tell them about it, and you get heaven and they get hell. When I think of it that way, who do I want to leave behind? Who's not worthy of hearing about Jesus Christ? And as I look at that and I think about that, I mean, I have got to be about doing what God wants me to do. However it is that God has me do it. And I told you my secret, my Walmart secret. Man, hit him with a card. It starts a conversation every time. Just run into them. Not hard, don't hurt them. Bump them enough to get their attention. And as the conversation goes on, I mean, they start off kind of, some start off kind of nasty. Hey, watch it. Sorry. And then you just kind of meld into it. Now, if you're not able to do that very well, I wouldn't do it. I have a lot of sore ankles, sore people around. But find your way to talk to people. To start a conversation and lead that conversation to love. The ultimate love, Jesus. And share that gift with those that are around. It'll be the greatest gift they ever get. So Micah tells his story. And you can read the book of Micah. Micah's an interesting book to read. It's interesting to go through some of the stuff he goes through. And read what he's putting there. I mean, it's all in there, what we talked about. He says, as in the days when you came out of Egypt, verse 15. He's talking about the Exodus. Nations will see and be ashamed, deprived of all their power. They will lay their hands on their mouths and their ears will become deaf. They will lick up dust like a snake, like creatures that crawl along the ground. I mean, he's talking about people not listening, people not doing, people not wanting to be him. He's talking about some of us who sit here every week and hear the word but do nothing with it. That's what he's talking about. Those who didn't know and didn't realize, who were they? Israel. What did God do to them? Sold them into bondage. How long? 400 plus years. Until they learned the lesson. And we've got this book here, and we can read from it. And we better learn the lessons, or we too, as America, could go in bondage. We too may need to be taught a lesson. It's all there. He talks about it, he goes through it. I mean, read that book of Micah and find out where he's at. But it ends with him saying what we need now. Love and unity. We need to be about one thing and one thing alone, and that is Christ and our relationship with Him. So test number two today. How's your relationship with Jesus? How's your walk with Him? Each week we give an invitation. Each week we ask you those questions, you know, how are you with Jesus today? How is your relationship with Him? Do you know him well enough to share him with someone else? Or do you still need to learn? Are you a minister or are you a mission field? Are you out telling people or do you need someone to come and keep telling you until you get? How long will it be? How many weeks do you have to sit in church and how many weeks do you have to go to Sunday school or dig in your own Bible before you get it? We've got to be about Jesus. We've got to be about sharing him because we may not have much longer here. Today might be it. Now, if you knew that today was it, at midnight tonight your life would end, how would you live today? Who would you find it urgent enough to tell about Jesus? Maybe we ought to start doing that. Because we're not guaranteed that tomorrow. So look at your life. Do you have Jesus? Do you have him to your fullest? Do you have enough of him that you have enough to share and give away and yet still take care of yourself? Is your relationship strong enough with him that if it ended right now, you know without a doubt where you'd spend eternity? We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. It's your opportunity to look at your life, to really examine yourself. Don't look at the person next to you or in front of you, behind you. Doesn't matter what they're doing, what's up. Just yourself. Are you ready for eternity? We've got to answer that question. And if we are we ready for it in heaven? Or are we ready for it in hell? It's the only two choices. Are we living the life that God wants us to live that would get us from here to there? To be his forever, to inherit it all? Or are we just playing games with it and maybe we'll miss out? You've got to decide. If you're here this morning, you've never given your life to Christ, it's your opportunity to give it to him. To make that life-changing choice to be his and his alone. To live this life that leads to eternity that we're talking about. To know what this love is all about. Or maybe you're here this morning, you've given your life to Christ at some point, and now you really need to think. How's my relationship with him? Am I in good footing that if it ended right now, I'd be his forever in eternity? Because if there's a question in your mind, there's doubt. Where there's doubt, there's loss. So as we stand and sing, if you have a decision to make, first time ever, or to get yourself reignited, reset with God, this is your opportunity.
You were condemned. I
Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. We thank you so much for your love for us, your concern that you sent your Son for us. Father, today we just pray that we're worthy, that we've accepted you, that our relationship with you is solid enough that, Father, we can do those things you placed before us. Our prayer today is that you'll give us things this week. Father, give us people to talk to and places to go that we can spread your word in this world and build your kingdom. Father, help us to be your hands and feet to honor you daily. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.